Hi, everybody. It's Tuesday. yeah, the holidays. I hope your holidays are so far going well. Your family is behaving and being reasonable. That's all we wish for the holidays, isn't it? My mom, a friend of Tested, my mom just arrived in town yesterday. I'm going to be here for the whole month. We're very excited. And yeah, I'm going to do a live stream today with a couple of show and tells from MythBuster days. And I've got some fantastic questions. These were open to everybody. These questions were open to everybody. I was telling Norm before we started this, man, the questions just get, the farther removed we are from the show, the better the questions get. There's some really wonderful, probing, interesting questions based off of people really watching the show and thinking, what if, thinking about our experience of making the show. It's really freaking delightful. But to begin with, I'd like to go over these show and tells because I've got two pieces. I have three pieces to show you, but I'm going to open with two of them. The first one I want to show is my pilot cockpit. This is, I'm really, really happy with how crunchy this looks. This is made out of crappy hardware store quarter inch ply. I think this is even Luon, right? So it's like one big pithy layer in the middle with two veneers. It's barely plywood. I slapped this together in about 2 hours on the MythBusters production. And the moment I finished painting it, I knew I wanted to keep this thing. So this was for the episode, maybe one of our most important episodes of what is the best way to board an airplane. We brought in a bunch of flight attendants who worked for Southwest. I've since run into two of them in the intervening years. One of them is still working for the airline as of like a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago. And yeah, I wasn't flying a year and a half ago. At any rate, these amazing flight attendants from Southwest were our guides in how to manage customers. We built a 200 plus, was it? Maybe it was 125 seat. Small body commuter airplane. Yeah, I think it was like 125, 130. And we filmed this up in Mare Island. And this is an episode made possible by the fact that our production team, over the latter half of making MythBusters from like 2009 forward, our production team became really, really good at wrangling volunteers for a story. This is not easy to do. When we did the Archimedes Death Ray using all the students of Encinal High School out there in Alameda, 500 kids, man, like, even when you're not paying 500 people, just keeping 500 people hydrated and fed and safe out of the sun all day long is an expensive proposition, and it's also a logistics-heavy proposition. And that story really kind of broke the dam on, I feel like, on bringing in more volunteers. And if I remember correctly, Yvette Solis was one of the key instigators at wrangling volunteers. She would bring in all of our zombies for the zombie episodes, all of our stormtroopers for the Star Wars episodes, and she got us our passengers. So we had like 150 people cooling their heels in a building across the street, and they got different kinds of instructions for boarding the airplane. The long and the short of it is the fastest way to board an airplane of all the ways there is random seat assignment, random boarding. The second you try and prioritize anyone's boarding experience, yes, slow it down by like a factor of two. Seriously, it is like the zones from the rear of the plane to the front is like a quarter of this. It's like four times longer to board a plane that way than random seat assignment. The Southwest way. Although the flight attendants told me that even with a fully empty plane, they would watch many passengers walk in and look at the empty plane with people behind them. Oh, I wonder where I'd like to sit. The world is my, they say that people just stand there in reverie over their choices. Okay, enough complaining about airplane passengers. I knew when we were making this episode and we were building our plane that I wanted to add some color to that. So I did two things. I started assembling a pilot's uniform, the three or four stripes on the collar, whether you're a captain or co-pilot, the right shirt, the right tie, the right hat. I'm here to tell you, it's not easy to assemble a pilot's uniform, and I didn't fully succeed. They make it difficult. The people that make these uniform parts make it difficult for you to, for you to reliably impersonate a pilot. And that strikes me as a probably good thing about the world. Like, it should be hard. It shouldn't be that easy. But I built a really lovely pilot uniform. And then I knew my pilot needed to have a cockpit. And I'm like, there's no way I'm gonna I can't take more than 2 hours to build this cockpit. And so this is what I made. And the third object I'm gonna show you today, which is in response to one of the questions I got, also drifts into this territory. This to me feels both playful and authentic enough that I feel like it drifts into the pantheon of a certain kind of modern art for me. People like Klaus Oldenburg and Eve Tangley, Robert Rauschenberg, the way Jasper Johns, the way these particular artists, and then ongoing Jenny Holzer and Barbara Kruger and Banksy, there's an irreverence to all of those artists' work, Marcel Duchamp, Tristan Zara and the Surrealists. There is a playfulness and a kind of thumbing your nose, both a playfulness about the world and a thumbing your nose at art that deeply invests in all of those artists' work. And I feel like this one does too. Like, the more I look at it in the future, in the intervening years since I built it, there's nothing I would change. I'm just so happy with it. And I really do think of it as a piece of early artwork from me. So I'm really glad I still have it. I will try and find this video. We did one shoot where I was pretending to steer the plane and the whole crowd was behaving along as if they were in turbulence. We will find it and we will figure out a way to get you to see it because it's so hilarious. It feels like an outtake from Craig Ferguson's old Late Late Show. Because that's absolutely who I was emulating as the pilot. Yeah. Craig Ferguson, one of the biggest fans of MythBusters in our entire history. I think he had all of the hosts on his show to sit on the couch and talk. No other talk show host did that. At any rate, that's my cockpit. On the other side is a much more important device because I believe it might be the only one in existence. When I was a kid, there was a joke, and the joke involved something impossible from a genie or somebody, and the punchline was, catch my fart and paint it green. And that's supposed to be the punchline because both of those things are supposed to be impossible. I don't know about painting a fart green, but I did build a machine to capture a fart, and here is my fart catcher. Yeah. Yeah. No, I know. I love this thing. So the whole idea was exploiting water pressure and air pressure and their differentials and the way those two materials behave when you put them under different constrictions. It utilized just natural water and air pressure to isolate the fart. I will walk you through its function. Do you empty it? Hold on, let's see here. Wait. Okay, so the funnel is meant to go in the bathtub to capture where the fart's gonna come out. That seems pretty self-evident. When you fart, it actually gets gathered by the bubble and the air volume of your flatus fills this vessel, this first vessel here, and it's got lines. I did this in milliliters or ounces. I actually figured out what the line divisions were so we could calculate the volume of the fart. I'm trying to piece this together because there's something I'm missing here. So you had the fart captured. Then the trick is, right. This vessel here is where the fart would eventually end up. And we would fill this with water all the way to the outer end. And what you would, wait a second. Oh, why don't I follow my directions? The rubber stopper is placed at the bottom of the graduated cylinder. That's what it is. I should have read my own directions. This went into the MythBusters exhibit. Yeah, you were all watching going, just read the directions. And I'm like sitting here trying to pull it out of my old brain. Right. So you'd capture the fart. You'd put a rubber plug in the bottom. Then you would fill this vessel with water. And that would actually allow the flatus to be pressured up into this vessel, which was full of water until the flatus arrived. The trick is to make sure that the water level in this cylinder is higher than the water level, than the tippy top of this vessel. And that means that water pressure brings the flatus up into the containment chamber. I will admit to you that over the weeks that we were filming the flatus episode, I was only able to capture two farts. It's just, look, we all have different productive periods in our day as we move through our day. And my productive period turns out to be between 5 and 6:30 in the morning. You're welcome. That's something you never wanted to know about me, but now you do. Other people have different productive times for their gas. And I love telling this story. My producer, Alice Dallow, one of the most intrepid producers I have or will ever work with and for, Alice was watching us flail around in this cold bathtub in the middle of Jamie's shop, and we were not getting what we wanted. We were not getting what we wanted, and she went, all right, everybody out. And she sent everybody out of the shop floor and said, give me an hour. And we came back an hour later, and she was like toweling off, and she had captured four. Dude, that is above and beyond. Absolutely freaking the champion. Alice was willing to go there, and I have nothing but mad respect for that. Dude, I mean, what I love about this is that it seems absurd. It sounds ludicrous. I made a fart catcher. But in the annals of science, it's right up the middle. Like, bat researchers who want to know about changes in diet and how they affect bat guano. How do you collect bat guano? Do you go into a cave and just wait to catch it? That's not very productive. But somebody figured out at one point a way of modifying t-shirt cutoffs to make these little tiny diapers for bats that they would poop in and then be able to collect a clean sample from the bat. That also sounds pretty much just as, diapers for bats sounds just as absurd to me as fart catchers. And yet, the bat methodology is actually yielding really interesting and useful information. Sorry, I'm getting a package. And that's one of the lovely things. Like, I love reading abstracts like, oh, well, we found, what was I don't have an example off the top of my head, but sometimes you read an experiment like, oh, an experiment researcher showed that men do this and women do this. And then when you go look at the methodology of how they achieved it, it's often hilarious or really, really brilliantly clever. By the way, for the rigorous scientists among you, yes, I am totally aware that the water we are moving the flatus through is affecting the chemical composition of the air of the flatus. Yes, I understand that the H2O was absorbing some, like, yes, all of that. But we were still able to use these to figure out which members of the crew had methane in their flatus and which ones of us didn't. I, by the way, am a methane burner. I can light my own farts, and I have. But this is, it sounds absurd, but it is science. And that's one of the most beautiful things about science is reading the wonderful, absurd ways in which people answered crazy questions with really simple, beautiful, brilliant methodologies. So I consider this one of my more important constructions, because I feel like the methodology is empirically sound, if not in its execution, it's lacking some rigor that one would prefer to have. Yeah. I'm never letting it go. It's always going to hang on the wall, just like a piece of art. Thank you so much for watching. If you'd like to support us even further, you can by becoming a tested member. Details are, of course, below, but it includes all sorts of perks, and we're building them all the time. You get advanced word and behind-the-scenes photos of some of our projects. Questions, you get to ask direct questions during my live streams, and we have some members-only videos, including the Adam real-time series of unbroken, unedited shots of me working here in the shop. They are weirdly meditative. Thank you guys so much. I'll see you on the next one.